Good morning to you, members and friends of Congregational Church of the Valley. We're glad that you're with us today as we celebrate in worship on July the 26th. We're doing all of this on media, of course, because we cannot meet together for this particular time. And we don't know exactly when we're going to be meeting together, but we'll stay in the present moment and use this medium by which we can join our hearts and our lives together. Unexpected Blessings is the sermon series that Sandi and I are preaching in harmony with each other. And we hope that as we look at the text today, blessed are the meek, that you will in some unexpected way be blessed. We welcome you to this service of worship.
Our scripture today is taken from the 5th chapter of Matthew. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Jesus continues in the Sermon on the Mount with another blessing. Blessed, happy, joyous are you. And we add that to the previous two that we've looked at already. Happy are you when you are poor in spirit or when you mourn. And now it says when you are meek. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. The most immediate response in our culture, in the United States of America, is not in our country, not in our culture. Dick, that just won't sell. I have two grandchildren. I have more grandchildren than that, but there are two that graduated this year, one from middle school and the other from high school in San Francisco. Both of those had to be done online. They're private schools with excellent teachers and great appreciation. And some real healthy kids seem to be lined up there going to graduation. I need to let you know that at the graduations of both of my grandchildren, there was nothing like, blessed are you meek, for you will inherit the earth. It was more like, blessed are you as you continue to keep learning with all the great stuff that we gave you so that you'll be very successful in life. I remember this was in the New Yorker one time. It said, there's an announcer on TV who says, this will surely disappoint the many meek people. The legacy has been successfully contested, and it's the arrogant who are to inherit the earth. Do you remember J. Paul Getty? He says, the meek inherit the earth, but they won't get the mineral rights. Maybe we can look a little bit deeper at this whole business surrounding the word meek. First of all, I want to talk a little bit about what meek is not. Meek does not mean weak. It's so vulnerable because it just almost sounds like it. Meek is weak. There's nothing about meekness that is weak except the sound of that word. Try this on from the Bible. Moses, it says he was very meek, more than all persons that were on the face of the earth. That's what it says in Scripture. And now if you look at Moses a little bit more closely, he went and killed a man. He got angry, smashed the Ten Commandments on the ground. Remember, folks, if you can remember back to that movie a long time ago, the Ten Commandments, to play Moses, they hired Charlton Heston, not Woody Allen. Meek does not mean also that you always give in. Mother Teresa, do you think of her as meek? Now, she would fit that profile. This nice little lady, and she's always got this, you know, wonderful look on her face. She looks like she's deeply spiritual, etc. Meek, I'm not sure if it fits her. You know, the first dying person that she picked up off the sidewalk in Calcutta was a man that she took to the emergency ward, and they would not take him in. And she said she would not leave until he was admitted. And you know how that turned out. He was admitted, and she formed a whole new ministry. Meek does not mean weak or giving in easily. Think of Jesus, Gandhi, Martin Luther King Jr., all died for the quiet persistence of doing that which is right. So let's take a look at what meek is. Let me give you three definitions of the word. Praus, P-R-A-U-S is how we'd spell it in our alphabet, is the word meek in the New Testament. There's a first level of it. The first level definition of meekness comes from Aristotle. He said that meekness is the place between excessive anger and angerlessness. His translation of the Beatitudes might be this: blessed is the one who is always angry at the right time and never angry at the wrong time. Mother Teresa got that and lived it. There's a second level of the definition of meekness. The word used when domesticating a horse. It was a common word in that domestication. The second level of definition could have produced this beatitude: blessed is the one who has every instinct, every impulse, every passion under control. Blessed is the one who is self-controlled. And then there's a third level definition: true humility, the acceptance of the limits of our learning. So we might translate it this way: blessed is the one who has the humility to know their own ignorance, their own weakness, and their own need for forgiveness. I love that translation. At 27 years of age, I think I have spilled the beans on that before, I could give you every answer to every theological question and make sense out of it. At least I was that legend in my own mind. And today, I'm in a very different place. When speaking of God, we are always looking through a glass darkly. Don't you remember that from 1 Corinthians, the 13th chapter? You know, we only see ultimate truth as if we are looking through a dirty piece of glass, a dark piece of glass. No matter how much we know on this earth, we see and we know only partially. Hartzell Cobb Sr., I like to mention his name, was the man who encouraged me to go into ministry in my teen years. And he was a guy who loved to open that Bible, and he could explain everything in my youth. He could explain everything. His son and myself, we went to seminary together, and Hartzell Cobb Sr., he went and read every book that his son was assigned while in seminary, and he came out in a very different place. The last time I was with my mentor, driving along in a car, and he said, well, I'll tell you what the bottom line is of all of this enterprise that you and I are in. It's all mystery, Dick. And I have learned to trust the one we only see in a glass darkly without having to explain a thing. The conclusion of William Barclay, a translation of this text, would be this: how blessed is the one who is always angry at the right time and never angry at the wrong time, who has every instinct and impulse and passion under control, because that person is God-controlled, who has the humility to realize their own ignorance and their own weakness and their need for forgiveness. For such a person is a true leader among all people. Now, that's quite a long, long translation, but all of those parts are very important. Meekness is quiet perseverance. You know, it was Michelangelo who said that genius is not something that you're born with or you learn about. Genius is eternal patience. Cole Bell, a great scholar, said that the biblical meekness is quiet perseverance in the face of brute rage. It is our staunch refusal either to lay down in submission or to rise up in violence before those forces that oppress us. Desmond Tutu is a marvelous example of mastering exactly what we're talking about here today in South Africa. All that Tutu would say was that he reminded his brothers and sisters that the relentless drive of Christian love would one day prevail over the repellent might of human hatred. And this nation that they had worked so hard to build indeed would be free. So he formed, after Nelson Mandela came into the office, the Truth and Reconciliation gathering. No one was going to go to jail. The truth needed to be spoken out in the open. Who was it that said one time that you shall know the truth shall make you free. Yes, that would be Jesus. Someone else said, the truth will set you free, but before that, it will make you mad as hell. Very difficult for us to look at some of those things that we've been so blind to. Many of those things are happening in the United States of America right now. There are some things that we are long overdue in looking at. And the promise is that if we dare to go into that very dark place sometime, that indeed we will be blessed with the light of day. You know, my brother was a cop. He was a policeman. And I admired him greatly. I got to ride with him one night in his highway patrol car in the state of California. I had a great couple in my church in San Diego. He was a detective, and she, a very attractive lady, was on the beat and oftentimes going to some of the toughest parts of San Diego. And she said to me one day, says, hey, Dick, you know, I got a tag here and you need to ride with me one day. Both with my brother and with those people in my church in San Diego, I confess to you that I had sweaty palms all the way. Just a simple example, just one of the calls was that a woman called and she was being abused in her home and her husband has a lot of guns and so we're going to go by that house. And he was out in the driveway, he had his hands in the air and all the guns lying down. And this police woman came and talked to him and said, now you know I have to take all of these guns, you know how this works, I'm going to put them in my trunk and you can go down to the police station and retrieve them. And she came with a calming voice to calm people down. There are many police men and women who are very good at doing that. And it appears in our culture that we're going to need people trained as well in sociology and psychology as they are in keeping the law in and among neighborhoods. And I'll give you a clue too. The only police that are ever respected are the ones who are in a cooperative effort with people in a community to keep the law and to keep the order where they live. Also, meekness knows where blessing is found. Why are we not blessed by these Beatitudes? It's because we try to alter their course rather than be blessed by their light. Did you hear that? These blessings that came from the mouth of Jesus. There's going to be blessings in unexpected places. We're saying that for 8 weeks. But we don't want to look at them. We want to alter their course. That looks a little bit too difficult, Nick. You got anything easier for me? No, we don't. They would rather alter the course rather than be blessed by the light that will most certainly come. I remember this great story that I dearly love. Talk about trying to alter the course of the Beatitudes. On the sea, there was a captain coming in a large ship, and he saw a light ahead of him, and he gave an order. And so an order came back from the light that he saw. The message came to the captain, Captain, alter your course by 10 degrees south. The response says, no, alter your course 10 degrees north. He said to the light that was approaching him. The captain, alter your course 10 degrees south. I am the captain of this ship. The response was, alter your course 10 degrees north. I'm a seaman third class. The captain finally said, alter your course 10 degrees south. I am a battleship. The response came, alter your course 10 degrees north. I am a lighthouse. Time to alter the course in America, to own our history, to speak the truth, be reconciled, walk in the light of God. Meekness knows the blessing of being a servant rather than a star. I brought up to you before the name of Philip Yancey, a journalist who's written some very important books as a part of his Christian faith. He had one article where he was comparing stars and servants. He went out to interview stars, I'm talking about movie stars, and then servants who were quietly giving themselves to what needed to be done next. He said, I interviewed many stars He said, they are as miserable a group of people as I have ever met. Most are troubled or broken. Nearly all are incurably dependent on psychotherapy or drugs. They are tormented with self-doubt. There are very few exceptions, he wrote. He said, when interviewing the servants, I was prepared to admire them, but not to envy them. The servants became for me the favored, the blessed, the graced ones. Kind of like Jesus said, the way it would be. He said, without question, I would rather spend time among the servants than among the stars. They possess qualities of depth and richness and even joy that I have not found elsewhere in life. Servants work for low pay, long hours, and no applause, wasting their talents and skills among the poor and the uneducated. Somehow, he said, in the process of losing their lives, they find life. Mother Teresa, come and speak to us. Mother Teresa, before you go off to that shore, that new shore, where did you find life in this world? She said, I met Jesus in his distressing disguise among the poor. One more time, and I'll leave you with this, the translation from William Barclay. How blessed is the one who is always angry at the right time and never angry at the wrong time, who has every instinct and impulse and passion under control, because that person is God-controlled, who has the humility to realize their own ignorance and their own weakness and their need for forgiveness. For such a person is a true leader among all people. And in addition, they know how blessed they are. May God bless us as we seek to follow as closely as we can these words from Jesus. Amen.
Let us pray together. Eternal God, help us in these precious moments of common prayer to hold in our hearts all who suffer with illness, those who have lost loved ones to the dreaded disease of COVID-19, those who lack enough food for their kids, and those who are anticipating a return to a job that is no longer there. We are overwhelmed with the suffering of your people. We know not how to plan for the day, let alone for the days that lie mysteriously ahead. We are likewise overwhelmed and grateful for the goodness of the human family that is revealed in churches, synagogues, hospitals, convalescent homes, and in the family room of patients who are exhausted, but holding it all together. Bless all of these we name and those unnamed this day who are doing the best of things in the most difficult of times. We thank you for all that keeps us believing that our years have meaning, that a knowing, caring hand is at the helm, that the resounding fury of the nations, politics, and strife is not the final sound, that love endures when tongues have ceased and prophecies have failed. We dare to pray these things in the name of the one who came and taught disciples, and so we are brave to pray the same. Our Father, who is in heaven, holy be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Amen. Thank you.
And now may the peace of God that passes all of our understanding, all of our greatest efforts, be with you, not only in this present moment, but forevermore. May the peace of God indeed be with you, we pray. Amen.